An affiliate of Christian Bible Institute and Seminary, a non-denominational Bible Institute founded as part of the Christian Education Department of the Upper Room Outreach Ministries Incorporated, based in Waycross, Georgia. BLBI has expanded now with an on-site campus in Kenya. Our mission is to equip men and women of God to be productive and functioning parts of the local body of Christ. VLBI provides affordable biblical education and leadership training for ministers, professionals, and laypersons. We will provide you with the skills, education, and character needed to effectively serve, equip, and shape the lives of others as they pursue excellence in Christian education, ministry, and leadership. Study on site at our Waycross campus or online in our Learning Center. Visit www.victoriouslbi.org. Call 1-833-884-8880.
Command your morning devotion and prayer live at 5 o'clock a.m. Monday through Friday at WHLJ 97.5 FM in Valdosta and Moultrie, Georgia. Also on Facebook Live on Mondays. You can also tune in by going to www.foxy97.com or call in to 678-079-611, access code 266-590. Evangelist Renee Sellers is your host.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. This is Evangelist Renee Sellers of the Upper Room Outreach Ministries in Waycross, Georgia, where my pastor is Pastor Samuel Sellers III. And we are live at 5 this morning on WHLJ 97.5 FM, Statenville, Valdosta, Moultrie, Georgia. You can also join us online this morning at Foxy, FOXY97.com. We are not on Facebook Live this morning. Our Christmas party had a little something to do with that last night. But anyway, we're live at 5 this morning on the air and online on the internet at www.foxyfoxy97.com. Listen, I didn't have time to get myself together for Facebook Live. But anyway, we're thankful today. You can call in this morning at 267-807-9611, access code 266-590. That's 267-807-9611, access code 266-590. We're still talking about the culture of the kingdom this morning. We are still in the Sermon on the Mount. I want to encourage you to keep on reading Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. We're going to briefly address the first beatitude that Jesus mentioned, because this sets the stage for all the other kingdom attitudes that Jesus outlines in the Sermon on the Mount. I want to talk about being a peacemaker this morning, because there has been so much division, conflict in the body of Christ even. And this message is for believers. The Sermon on the Mount is for those of us in the church, those of us who believe, those of us who are true followers of Jesus Christ, his disciples. I'm going to give you some resources to invest in, because I believe every ministry, every pastor and leader needs to teach and equip their people on how to resolve conflict within the body of Christ. We need to understand and deal with issues of conflict. And that issue of conflict with another individual often begins with a conflict on the inside of you and or me. Our failure to resolve conflict gets in the way of glorifying God. How many of us today have a conflict with another individual and we have never taken the opportunity to be the peacemaker in the situation? How many of us today have a conflict or an issue with another person, another brother or sister in the Lord? You know, in the world, we're going to have conflict. This is why we have murders. This is why we have abuse. This is why we have adultery. This is why we have physical abuse, even in marriage, because people who do not know God or who say they know God but do not live like they do they're not going to do their part to be peacemakers. We might try to keep peace, which is another thing altogether. But we're going to go down in the text, and we're just going to go through the Sermon on the Mount. We're not going to go, I want you to read it. I want to encourage you to read it line upon line. But we're going to pull out different aspects of this sermon as we talk about the culture of the kingdom. But I want to deal with being a peacemaker, and this is not going to stop today. I'm just going to introduce it, and this is something that we're going to talk about for a few days, and I may bring on Apostle Weems. But let me get into prayer this morning. I want to encourage you to grab your notepads, grab your Bibles, grab your pen. We're going to talk about what it means to be a peacemaker this morning, not a peacekeeper. We got too many peacekeepers in the body of Christ, and that's one of the reasons we got people hopping from church to church to church. It's time for us to grow up in our relationship with God. Evangelist Paulette Griffin, woman of God, open us up this morning with a word of prayer.
Heavenly Father, we've come giving you glory, praise, and honor, and thanking you for another day, another opportunity to be able to come before thy throne room of grace to obtain mercy, power, deliverance, and healing. We thank you for the open heaven, the fresh anointing, for stirring up the very gifts in us, Lord God, as we come together from the north, the south, the east, and the west, together in your name, giving you glory, praise, and honor for this day and every day, Lord God. Thank you for breathing the breath of life into us, Lord God, making us living netfishes. Thank you for another opportunity to adore and praise your name. Thank you, Lord God, for opening up our spiritual mind, ears, and hearts to receive thy word this day that it may be planted upon good ground, to come up into fruition as you called it to be. We come to give you glory and praise for this day, Lord God, and thank you for all that you've done. For thine, O Lord, you are the greatness and the power, the victory and the majesty, for all that is in heaven and earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all. We know no other help but thee. We come giving you glory and praise for the Upper Room Outreach Ministries, Pastor Samuel, Dr. Evangelist Renee Sellers, for bringing forth Command Your Morning Prayer Line, Lord God, that we will learn more of your word, Lord God, that your word will come up into fruition as you called it to be, to plant it upon good ground, Lord God. Heavenly Father, that we shall help to hide the word in our hearts, that we will not sin against thee. Do thy divine and perfect will, Lord God, in season and out, Lord God, to be true vessels of honor for your divine and perfect will. We thank you for all things in the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, woman of God. My subject this morning is for the glory of God. Because our desire to be peacemakers demonstrates that we have a desire to do all that we do to bring glory to God in our relationships, in our business dealings with people, with our everyday dealings with people, in our marriages, with our children. I shared with someone the other day that there are moments that that we, as parents, it's okay to apologize to our adult children. It's okay to sit down and do the best. I thank the Lord. I'm thankful for the relationship that I have with my girls, and it probably started, you know, with us growing up and being, you know, homeless. We didn't even realize we were homeless. We were living with somebody else. We didn't realize, you know, we didn't look at it as being homeless, but that's what we were, having to share the same bed for years. Yes, your girl did not have a place of her own to live for many, many years, and I lived with my parents for years, and me and my children shared one room, me and three children, one room in my parents' house, homeless. And they got a name for it, and I can't remember what it is today in the school system, but that's where we were. And that probably stemmed from us having to sleep in the same bed together for all those years. We pretty much grew up, and we are very close, and I thank God for that. But there are moments that my children and I do not always agree. And as a mother, there are moments that I have had to call my girls and say, I'm sorry. And there are moments, watch this. It's not that I said what I said was not right, but the conversation may not have always gone the right way. I may have gotten a little bothered by some things and may not have said something the right way, and I apologize for that. And that's a part of being a peacemaker. And yes, we talk it out. We talk about the issue. And so many of us are sweeping things under the rug, but we're not resolving issues with our brothers and our sisters. We're not resolving issues with our parents. And as Lady Whitaker and I, even in marriage sometimes with couples, we will move past some things in marriage but we never resolve those things. We will be peacekeepers. I'm just going to be quiet about this for now. You know, we're not going to talk about this right now. And eventually, you never talk about it, so therefore you never resolve it. And what happens when you never resolve it, there is some internal conflict that results. And what happens when there is internal conflict, there is resentment sets in, unforgiveness sets in, and then 15 years later, you're bringing that stuff back up again. Why? Because you never made peace. You just move past. You never sat down and talked about it. You just moved past it. You never dealt with it. Jesus is trying to help us develop a new attitude. In the Sermon on the Mount, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to go back just a little bit to what I shared yesterday with Upper Room, that there are oftentimes Jesus is trying to help us develop a kingdom mentality. Listen, you are a citizen of the kingdom of heaven now. Listen, you don't have to wait until you die to be a citizen of the kingdom. Listen, you are born again. You are a citizen of the kingdom. You have dual citizenship. And as part of being a citizen of the kingdom, our attitude and our responses to life situations should not be the same as they were in the world. I know in the world, that you walk away from somebody when you got mad and you say, I'm going to love them from a distance. Is that glorifying God? I know when you got an attitude with somebody when you was in the world, you probably jump on them, cuss them out, and then feel and still feel good about it. Is that the attitude of a citizen of the kingdom? So we're going to talk about for the glory of God, because as a citizen of the kingdom, everything we do should point to him. Everything we do should point to him. Every attitude, our behavior, everything should point to him. So let's go to Matthew chapter 5 and verse 9, and we're going to also go back to Matthew chapter 5 and verse 3. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Conflict, which is a result of some issue between people, between parties, conflict is an opportunity to glorify God. I know you don't see it that way, but I pray you see it that way by 6 a.m. on December 13, 2021, that conflict is an opportunity to glorify God, not to run away from the situation, not to go out and gossip about the person you have a conflict with, not to sit back and be mad and give each other the silent treatment, not to say, I'm going to love you from a distance, and you going to the same church, you serving on the same team, but you ain't talking to each other. Is that glorifying God? You sleep in the same bed and you haven't spoken in the last 3 days. Is that glorifying God? Even with me and Pastor Sellers and I, the first thing we think about is does our response to each other bring glory to God? And because we have developed a different mentality as kingdom citizens, we don't go to bed angry for days like we used to. We don't go, you know, all day long and have this mad, you know, at you. We don't respond. We do our best not to do that, but definitely we don't go to bed mad. It's been years since we went to bed and for days, and that was a result of only thinking about ourselves. Can I be transparent for just a moment? Those times that he and I went to bed and didn't speak to each other for days, that was a result of pride. That was a result of selfishness. That was a result of me, myself, and I. But Jesus is trying to help us develop a mentality that we look to God and we ask ourselves, what would God think about this? What would God think about how I dealt with my husband? What would God think about how I responded to Lady Whitaker? What would God think about this? The first thing that should come to our mind when we deal with people is, how is this going to glorify God? How is my response going to glorify God? And so thereby, as we go back just a little bit, you know, we're already talking about the fact that Jesus announces the kingdom, and the first word in the gospel message is repent. Matthew 4:17, he says, repent. Well, John the Baptist has already said it, and then here Jesus is, and the disciples were taught to do the same thing. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The New Living Translation of this same verse says, repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is here. As I read this the other day and on Sunday, I read a quote that says, repentance corrects the will. In other words, it's not my will when we repent and turn to God. It's thy will be done. And so a lot of people are not speaking to each other. A lot of couples are not speaking to each other. Brothers and sisters in families are not speaking to each other. Older siblings are arguing about land and property and money. They're not speaking to each other because it's about their own will. But repentance corrects the will to where it's no longer about me, but it's about God. Can I get somebody to shout amen this morning and say, for the glory of God? I think we're going to close out with For Your Glory by Tasha Cobbs. If we will not repent through fear of evil, in other words, if we do not repent because of trying to escape hell, then maybe we'll repent because of blessings. Maybe we'll repent because of the fact that we are to be approved by God. Maybe we'll repent. It will be when Jesus pronouncing blessings on those who demonstrate these kingdom attitudes or kingdom mentality. Because those who repent and turn to God are blessed. We are fully satisfied. We are spiritually prosperous. Can somebody say we are to be approved by God? In the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes, the attitudes to be about these kingdom attitudes, Jesus is providing the opportunity for those of us who hear his message to develop a new attitude. He's providing opportunity for those of us who are reading from this at this moment on Command Your Morning. You're reading along with us. Oh, God, listen, the first blessing, blessed are the poor in spirit. When we understand what that means, we recognize our need for God. We are destitute without God. We know that we are nothing, oh God, in his presence. Oh God, those who are poor in spirit, that should have been the first opportunity for us to change our mind, to change our mentality, to develop a new attitude. Can somebody say, I'm a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. I don't think the way I used to think. I don't act the way I used to act. I don't talk the way I used to. My prayer life is different. Somebody shout amen. I'm feeling real good right now this morning. And so thereby, Jesus is connecting each blessing with a promise. And I talked about insurance and assurance the other day. Jesus, oh God, with the blessing is giving us assurance. Blessing are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The blessing for those who are poor in spirit, those who recognize that they need God more than anything else. Ladies and gentlemen, the kingdom, oh God, belongs to them. And in the kingdom, oh God, no, there is no lack in the kingdom. Prayers are answered in the kingdom. Oh God, promises are kept in the kingdom. God looks out for his subjects, oh God, in the kingdom. Somebody ought to say, oh God, the kingdom belongs to me. Not after I take my last breath, but I'm seated in heavenly places even now. And so, ladies and gentlemen of the jury this morning, you are blessed, spiritually prosperous, oh God, as we demonstrate this kingdom mentality. And there's an assurance, a promise of things that will be yours. And so as we look at the Sermon on the Mount, this is a system. Some people call it the Constitution of the Kingdom, a system of laws and principles which was to govern the king's subjects during his reign. And as I said the other day and yesterday, that Jesus is still king, Jesus still reigns. So we are to be governed by kingdom principles. I know we're citizens of the United States of America, but we're citizens of the kingdom of heaven. His principles take precedence. Can I say that again for those in the back of the room? His principles take precedence. Because number one, when we are living by the principles that are outlined in the Word of God, then living as citizens of the United States would not be an issue. We would not be committing crimes. We would not be committing ungodly acts toward one another. We would do right by each other. We would pay our taxes. We would obey the law and the authority, the police, the Georgia State Patrol. We'd do right by them as citizens of the kingdom. Why? Because we don't want to misrepresent the king. We are salt and light, as the Sermon on the Mount tells us. We don't want to misrepresent the king. Can somebody say represent? Because even in our everyday doing, driving down the street, I was so embarrassed to get a speeding ticket within two weeks by the same officer who is my neighbor, who knows that I'm saved, who knows that we lead a ministry. I was so embarrassed to get that ticket, but thank God that he gave me grace, and I thank God for his grace. But because I was so embarrassed, and it wasn't just getting the ticket. It was the fact that I'm saved and I'm dealing with this happening again. He's got to look me in the face again. I'm embarrassed because this did not glorify God. This did not glorify God. And so, as I said, not too long ago, I did a workshop on ethics. The Sermon on the Mount establishes a pattern for ethics. I got to repeat this because repetition helps us to remember. The Sermon on the Mount establishes a pattern for ethics and behavior that applies to everyday life situations. Even getting a speeding ticket, ladies and gentlemen, does that speeding down the road glorify God? And how many have been in accidents or cost somebody their life because as citizens of this country, we neglected to obey those regulations, which as citizens of the kingdom, did that disobedience glorify God? And so we got to learn to use this pattern as a guide for everyday life. We have discovered so much more about the word blessed. We already talked about the fact that it means more than just happy. While many translators and your amplified translator and all those commentators, I thank the Lord for commentators. I thank God for commentaries. I use them. I study from them. I thank God for them. But I know that being blessed is more than being happy. We are not as citizens of the kingdom this morning. I want to encourage you. Listen, I need you to say this to yourself. I'm not limiting myself to just being happy. I'm not limiting myself to what is happening to me. Because if I limit myself to what's happening to me, every time something goes wrong, I'm going to go left. Come on, somebody. Every time something does not go right, I'm going to go left. I'm going to be messed up. And some people, because they want to be happy, they think that every day is going to be sunshine. They think that every day as a believer is going to be Sunday. Some people have walked away from God and walked away from church because they felt like, well, I'm supposed to be doing better than I was before. The issue is, watch this now, you will have trials. Jesus already told us that in this life you will have tribulation, but he said, be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Ladies and gentlemen, be of good cheer. Rejoice in the Lord always. Count it all joy, ladies and gentlemen, but do not limit yourself to just something that is happening to you. Only being happy when things are going good. Only being happy when you got enough money. Only being happy when you got a car to drive. Only being happy when you got the nice dress. Only being happy, oh God, when you got food on the table. Rejoice in the Lord always. Can somebody say, again, I say rejoice. Nehemiah lets us know that the joy of the Lord is our strength. Joy, oh God, the fruit of the Spirit, if you notice in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, and I believe it's 23 and 24, it does not say anything about the fruit of the Spirit is happy. But it does say, Pastor Wright, that the fruit of the Spirit is love and peace and joy and patience and faithfulness and self-control and goodness and all those other attributes. It doesn't say anything about being happy because God does not want us to be limited to what's happening. Oh, God, he does not want us to be limited to when things are going good. That's the only time you got a smile on your face. And so this morning I want to encourage you that we are blessed. God, we are blessed. We are blessed. We are blessed. And it means more than being happy. It's okay, but don't limit yourself. Don't limit yourself. As we're developing a kingdom mindset, we're not limiting ourselves to only feeling good when things are going good. Because if I limit myself to feeling good only when things are going good, then that's when discouragement and depression has an opportunity to control our emotions. It has. Listen, don't allow life situations to control you. You take authority over that. You have joy no matter what. I need somebody to shout amen. Going to court with one of my children, and the lawyer telling me there's nothing I could do. That child going to get 5 years probation and 6 months in prison. I said, the devil is a liar. And when my daughter was discouraged, ladies and gentlemen, I had enough joy on the inside of me to tell my child, you worried about something that God has already taken care of. See, when you have the joy of the Lord, when I got joy, joy, joy down in my heart, ladies and gentlemen, listen, I won't even let this kind of report after I done prayed for 3.5 years for different results, I would not let that steal my joy. And somebody needs to shout amen. You've been praying about it. You've been asking God to move. You've been declaring the word of God. Don't let what you see in the natural rob you of your joy. I need somebody to shout amen and say, for the glory of God, I'm developing a kingdom mentality. I'm not letting anything get in the way. I'm not going to let it rob my joy. If we limit ourselves to feeling good only when things are going good, that's when discouragement and depression has an opportunity to gain control. But developing a kingdom mentality means taking authority over what is trying to take control of you. Don't let the enemy rob you and control your move. Don't let him do it. That's what he wants to do. That's why the Bible tells us to put on the whole armor of God, Ephesians chapter 6. Put on the whole armor of God so that we can stand against the wiles of the devil. Put on the helmet of salvation. The enemy wants to penetrate and affect the way you think. But Jesus is giving us a new way of thinking. In the garden of in Genesis, has God said that question that the serpent asked the woman is causing her to think about what God has said? And what the enemy wants her to do is he wants to mess with, he messed with her thinking. He is the master of deception. He messed with her thinking. All this started in the garden, messing with people's minds. And this is what Jesus is trying to help us do. Have his mind, the mind of Christ. Your mind renewed daily, ladies and gentlemen. God allows us to have things. And so as we talk about being blessed and highly favored, I'm blessed and highly favored. A lot of us limit being blessed to having the nice house. We limit being blessed to having the nice car. We limit being blessed to the clothes and the bags and the money, the paycheck and the job. We limit being blessed. Oh, I'm blessed because I just got my degree. I just graduated from college on this past weekend. Oh, I'm so blessed. And yes, you are blessed. You're blessed and highly favored. But you don't limit yourself to that. God allows us to have nice things as rewards for our faithfulness while we live in this earth. Those things mean nothing, ladies and gentlemen, if we do not have Jesus. Those things mean nothing if we don't have God. And when we have Jesus, we have his attributes. We have the fruit of the Spirit. We have that kind of joy and that kind of love and that kind of patience. The fruit of the Spirit are ours. So, ladies and gentlemen, oh God, as you're listening this morning, the kingdom belongs to those who are poor in spirit. And Jesus starts with there, those who see themselves as nothing before God. They see themselves as totally helpless to save themselves. They know that they need God. They know that they need Jesus. They know that they need a Savior. They know that they're nothing, destitute without him. Ladies and gentlemen, destitute without him. So Jesus says to repent in Matthew 4 and 3. And another definition of this word repent is to think differently. We often say change one's mind. What does that mean? To think differently. The enemy started with messing with our minds in Genesis. Jesus came as the first Adam, allowed things to happen. The last Adam is trying to help us develop a new mentality and think differently. I read this definition yesterday. Think differently or afterwards. That is, reconsider morally to feel compunction. So let me define the word compunction. Compunction means a feeling of guilt or moral scruple that prevents or follows the doing of something bad. True repentance is a result of feeling guilty and feeling guilt for sin, sorry for sin, not sorry that I got caught, not sorry that I got arrested, not sorry that my name is in the newspaper, not sorry. When I worked there, when I was in training at BCOT and before I started in 1995, started working with the Department of Corrections, I had one of the best trainers I think the Department of Corrections had. Because every day she would put this in our ears, as it relates to personal dealings with inmates, she would put this in our ears. If you do this or that, you lose your house, your car, and everything you work so hard for. If you do this or that, you lose your house, your car, and everything you work so hard for. Repetition helps us to remember. But there was still about half of the students in the class that did not get it. And ladies and gentlemen, the Lord, watch this now. Sorry I got caught, but not sorry for what I did. And that means, watch this now. Now, if we're not sorry for sin, then we are destined to do it again. Where's Lady Anderson this morning? If we are not sorry, godly sorry, the Bible says that therefore godly sorrow worketh repentance. For 2 Corinthians 7 and 10, godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of, but the sorrow of the world worketh death. If we are not sorry for sin, then we are destined to repeat it again, to do it again, because repeat means do it again. But anyway, so Jesus is challenging them, and as we read and study today, he is challenging us to think differently. For the glory of God, quick break for station ID. For the glory of God, this morning is my subject. For the glory of God, conflict is an opportunity to glorify God. We're going down to what it means to be a peacemaker. We're going to touch on it, and we're going to finish it one day this week. But we're live at 5 this morning on WHLJ 97.5 FM, Statenville, Valdosta, Moultrie, Georgia. You can also join us online this morning at Foxy, FOXY97.com. And you can join us on the conference call with these awesome men and women of God at 267-807-9611, access code 266-590. I want to talk about this, that other Greek word that we discussed, for blessed, or Greek definition rather, which means to be approved by God. So when you go through the text, and I know you're probably reading from the Amplified, yes, all those definitions are valid, but I don't want us to be limited to the word happy. Blessed or to be approved by God is probably more appropriate or more suitable for this particular passage. Blessed or to be approved by God are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed or to be approved by God are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed or to be approved by God are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed, or to be approved by God, are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled, so on and so forth. Bishop Hatcher has pretty much summed most of this up, but we're going to move on down in the text. Jesus begins this sermon with pronouncing blessings on those who recognize that they are nothing in the presence of God. And this is strategic, as Jesus always was strategic. Our Father is strategic because we need to recognize our need for God if we're going to demonstrate the character of a kingdom citizen. W.R. Lucci said these words. He said, the culture of those of us who embrace the kingdom concept is one of obedience to God's constitution. Remember I said some commentators call the Sermon on the Mount the constitution of the kingdom. And so he says, W.R. Lucci says, the culture of those of us who embrace the kingdom concept is one of obedience to God's constitution, meaning obeying what they have read and living in obedience to the king. Obeying what you read, not just being hearers but doers also, and living in obedience to the king. That brings glory to God. So Matthew 5 and 9 says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. The Greek word for peacemakers means the founders of peace. I read one some time ago that said those who love peace, but it's really more than that. One definition says those who love peace, but it really means more than that for you and I as believers. Founders of peace, those of us who are founders of peace. And as I studied in Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 through 6, you can go there, because in that Jesus gives us qualifications of the peacemaker, qualifications of the peacemaker. Paul says this about Jesus in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14 through 17. It says in Matthew 5 and 9, for they shall be called. So blessed or to be approved by God are the peacemakers, though the founders of peace. For they shall be called the sons of God. The blessing is pronounced on the peacemakers. The assurance or the promise is they shall be called the sons of God. Jesus is peace. He is Jehovah Shalom. Our Father, the Father and the Son are one. Paul says in Ephesians chapter 2, 14 through 17, for he is our peace, Jehovah Shalom, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of partition between us, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were afar off and to them which were nigh. As we talk about being a peacemaker, the message of peace is the message of the gospel. Jesus is teaching this gospel message about being a peacemaker. Blessed are the peacemakers. And I want us to understand this about the sons of God. As I study in the Hebrew, the word peace, shalom in the Hebrew, shalom in Hebrew, is not a negative state. It denotes not simply the absence of evil, but is a positive word which has to do with the well-being of another, seeking for him the highest good. So as peacemakers, we are doing our part to seek the highest good on behalf of other people. We are kingdom citizens, and we are to esteem others higher than ourselves. And so thereby, every opportunity that we have to be peacemakers, we should utilize that opportunity. Being a peacemaker, as one commentary writes, I believe this is Thomas Nelson. He says, being a peacemaker is to work for right relations between people, not just those that are black, not just those that are white or tan or brown, not just those that are part of your group, your neighborhood, your socioeconomic group, not just those that are Democrat. I think time now for believers, it's a choice, but we need to really rethink some things. Because if it's creating division, do we really want to be a part of anything that is breaking peace, that is bringing discord, that is creating division? But anyway, it's not about, I'm not just looking out for Democrats, I'm not just looking out for Republicans, I'm not just looking out for those in Washington, I'm not just looking out for those in the impoverished neighborhoods. But to be a peacemaker means that we're working for right relations between all people, every individual. And I've had, as we are, and I didn't mean to clear my throat on the air, please forgive me, as we have been a part of this arena for the last 2 years or last 3 or 4 years in this political arena, there has been a lot of divisiveness among people in the church because of politics. There's been division. And people have stopped speaking to each other. People have left churches. People have stopped tuning in to Command Your Morning and stopped listening even to me because of politics. And even when attempts were made to make peace, those attempts went, I would say, there was no resolve. Because people, what did I say? Repentance corrects the will. And for those who still desire their own will, it's time to repent. For those who still desire their own will to the degree that I'm not speaking to another brother or sister in Christ, we need to repent. For those who have resolved to their own will instead of allowing repentance to correct the will and allowing God and Christ to rule your heart, and we're not speaking to the person that goes to church with us, we need to repent. A lot of us think we're okay because somebody else did us wrong and we're not speaking to them. We think we're okay because they of our perception of what they did to us. We think we're okay because I'm preaching and I'm a man or woman of God. I don't have to speak to them because of what they did to me. We think we're okay getting up in that pulpit and preaching. If you have unforgiveness in your heart, if there is resentment in your heart, if there is unresolved conflict and you have not even attempted to talk to the individual, sit down somewhere until you get it together, because Jesus is showing us a new way of thinking and a new way of behaving. And does our grace in the pulpit and not speaking to another brother or sister in Christ glorify God? And not even having made an attempt. I'm talking about those who have not even made an attempt to try to resolve it, because there are those of us who have made attempts And it's not our fault that the other person is not responding the same way we are. I want to encourage somebody, listen, you off the hook. If you made an attempt to resolve the issue, you made an attempt to bring peace to the situation, you are off the hook. But for those who still feel like I'm right because they did me wrong, and I don't feel like speaking to them, I don't even want to talk to them, I don't even want to deal with them again, if the opportunity is available for you to talk to them, the Bible tells us that we are to go to them. And blessed and be a true peacemaker. As believers, as followers of Jesus Christ, Thomas Nelson tells us that the Christian church has a calling which will separate the children of God from people of violence and war. Let me say that again. That the church, the believers, you and I, brothers and sisters, we have a calling that separates us from the world. It separates us from the old way we used to do things, the old way we used to respond. As kingdom citizens, come on, somebody, we have to embrace this new way of living. We got to embrace this new concept. We got to embrace this new way of thinking, because this new way of thinking, oh, God, gives us access to the benefits and the blessings of citizens of the kingdom. You cannot get, you expect God to respond to your prayer, but you're still holding in unforgiveness. You want God to, oh, God, to keep his promise, but you haven't been faithful to him. Come on, through obedience and resolving conflict. You want God to move on your behalf, but you are not, oh God, honoring him. And the Bible lets us know they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, doing God's will and doing it his way, those that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. You want God to move for you? Walk in obedience to him. And so we're going to talk about being a peacemaker. Peacemakers are the people, are those of us who bring change, those of us who initiate change, those of us who are intentional about resolving conflicts with other people. There have been situations where people have been in conflict and others knew about it, but how many of those others did their part to bring resolution? We see what is happening, we hear what is happening, but did you pick up the phone and tell sister girl or brother man that you need to go talk to them? That's one way to be a peacemaker, is to encourage the person that came to you to go talk to the person that they have an issue with. And if they bring that issue to you, and I understand in counseling, that's something different, but as a counselor, we're obligated to give people wise counsel and lead them in the right direction. I know we can't divulge information. I know we can't talk about it unless that person says, I'm going to kill somebody, I'm going to kill myself. Then we have the duty to warn. But in cases of confidentiality, what we are to do is encourage that individual to talk to that other person. Now that we're in this situation where we are demonstrate confidentiality, now that person has responsibility. That person has responsibility, and we give godly counseling, Christian counseling, and even in other areas of counseling, there's still wise counsel that is utilized. And, you know, a lot of us don't realize it, but much of psychology stems from the Word of God, whether we want to accept that or not. And so as we talk to people, we encourage them to talk to that individual, go to them. Now they have responsibility. Now they are accountable for responding to the wise counsel that has been given. Jesus gives wise counsel in his word. We are responsible once we receive that wise counsel. Once we know better, ladies and gentlemen, we got to learn to do better. We are responsible for what we know. We are responsible for what we know. And so as peacemakers, we got to bring change we are responsible for bringing change in the kingdom of God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. We shall be called the sons of God. And what that means overall, ladies and gentlemen, is we demonstrate the character of Jesus Christ, who is peace. We demonstrate his character. We represent him in the earth. We demonstrate that we have his DNA when we do our part as peacemakers. Being a peacemaker is not running away from the problem, and that's what we got to stop doing as believers. Too many of us are running away from the problem and we're still mad. Too many of us are running away from the problem and that's why we got divorced. Too many of us are running away from the problem and that's why we don't get along with our family. Too many of us are running away from the problems, ladies and gentlemen. We're running away from the problem or we're running away from the issue. And if we're running away from it, we are not dealing with it. And later on in life, if you don't deal with it, it's going to deal with you. Can somebody say, for the glory of God? This is what Jesus said in John 14:27. He says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So, you and I are believers, there are four things that I want us to remember, and we're going to come back to this, and I may have to come back on Transformation Tuesday, but we'll see, so we don't break this up, but we'll see. Four G's of being a peacemaker, and we're going to close with this. We're going to talk about them later on this week. Ken Sand, in college, we had to take a class on conflict resolution. And one of the books that we had to purchase was The Peacemaker, A Biblical Guide to Resolving Personal Conflict. Talking about being peacemakers. And being a peacemaker is about conflict resolution. Being a peacemaker causes us to have to resolve conflicts. And there are four G's that Mr. Sand outlines in his book to resolving conflict or being a peacemaker. Number one, glorify God. Number two, get the log out of your eye. Number three, gently restore. And number four, go and be reconciled. I want to talk about glorifying God because being a peacemaker, we are motivated and guided by a desire to bring glory to God. I need us to think about that as a kingdom citizen. The mentality of a kingdom citizen is we are motivated in every relationship and every situation to glorify God. We want to bring honor to Him. We want to bring honor to Him. So what we do is we reconcile relationships. We go to that individual. We don't wait for them to come to us. We go to them. Come on, somebody. We go to them and we do our part, ladies and gentlemen. We extend grace to those who have not been gracious to us in the name of Jesus because we love God first. Can somebody say we got to love the Lord with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love our neighbor as ourselves. Those are the two greatest commandments, and all the others are sealed on those. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we have to do our part because you are blessed when you do your part, oh God, to resolve issues. You are blessed when you do your part to bring reconciliation. You are blessed when you do your part to go to that individual and do what is necessary to make peace, not just keep peace. We are blessed or approved by God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons or the children of God. Before we go, because we're going to talk about this, we're going to pick this up tomorrow morning, Pastor Wright, because I want to finish dealing with this before the end of the week. We're going to pick this up tomorrow. We're going to talk about this being a peacemaker. And Ken Sands says this in his book, as we draw on His grace, God's grace, follow His example, and put His teachings into practice, we can find freedom from the impulsive, self-centered decisions that make conflict worse. This is going to give us opportunity to evaluate not the other person, but ourselves. There needs to be a whole lot of people who listen to this on this week. As we draw on His grace, follow His example, and put His teachings into practice, we can find freedom from the impulsive, self-centered decisions that make conflict worse. What are some self-centered decisions? I don't want to talk to you anymore. What are some self-centered decisions? We're not going to talk about it. Let's just get over it. What are some self-centered decisions? We don't need counseling. Let's just do what we do. What are some self-centered decisions? I'm going to love you from a distance, which means in a nutshell, you know what that means. Listen, we don't get along, so let's just keep it that way. That's really what that means. I'm going to love you from a distance. We don't get along. Let's just keep it that way. I'm not going to do my part. You stay in your lane. I'm going to stay in mine. But as believers, does that mentality glorify God. That's all I'm going to talk about today. We're just introducing our next point in this journey in the Sermon on the Mount, the culture of the kingdom, developing a kingdom mentality. We can have the peace of God while we live in this life, even though life is chaotic, circumstances happen, life happens. We can have the peace of God, and we can truly, when we have the mind of Christ, then we are determined and motivated with a desire. It is in our heart to be peacemakers. We're going to pick this up tomorrow morning, live at 5, but I want to encourage you to invest in the peacemaker by Ken Sand. We talked about this before on Command Your Morning. We're going to do it again because repetition helps us to remember. I'm going to ask Pastor Gloria Moore Wright to close us out with a word of prayer, but also before she does that, I want to provide some other resources on peacemaking for those of you to invest in. Number one, Redeeming Church Conflicts by Tara Barthel and David Edling. Peacemaking Women by the same author, and The Peacemaking Pastor by Alfred Perrier. You can look them up for yourselves. We're talking about blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God, those of us who demonstrate Christ-like character. Pastor Gloria Moore Wright, woman of God, take us in with a word of prayer, and Tasha Cause is going to close us out with For Your Glory.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Lord God, we thank you for this devotion today. Help us to hide it in our hearts, that we might not sin against you. Restore all the virtue that have gone out of this, your servant, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Bless all those that are in the listening audience. Help us to hide your word in our hearts, that we might not sin against you. Help us to not just be, help us to be peacemakers, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, not just peacekeepers. Help us to do our part, God, and go beyond our part in the name of Jesus. Father, we just thank you today for giving us a mind to glorify you. We want you to get the glory out of everything we say, everything we do, Father. So we pray, God, that you would lead us, guide us, direct our paths and our every footstep. We pray for those that are in need of prayer today, God, that you would meet them right where they are, that you would bless right now, God, that you would heal, that you would deliver, that you would set free, and that you would make whole in Jesus' name. We'll continue to lift you up. We'll continue to praise you, and we'll continue to bless your holy and righteous name in Jesus' name. Amen, and glory be to God.
Hallelujah. Glory be to God. So this morning you can declare, I am a peacemaker. I am a peacemaker because I have a desire in my heart to do what is necessary to glorify God. I am a child of God. I am forgiven of all my sins. I am washed in the blood of Jesus. I am a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. And because I am a citizen of the kingdom of heaven, I have a new attitude. I have a kingdom mentality. I have the mind of Christ, and my mind is renewed daily. I am more than a conqueror, ladies and gentlemen. I am an overcomer, and I am determined to do my part, oh God, to bring reconciliation, to relationships, to my marriage, to my family relationships. I am determined to do my part to make peace, oh God, to seek peace and pursue it in Jesus' name. Oh God, I am seated in heavenly places even now. I am an expression of the life of Christ because he is my life. I demonstrate Christ-like attributes. I have love. I have joy. I have peace in Jesus' name. I am a son or a daughter of light and not of darkness. And because I am a son of light and not of darkness, I will let my light so shine before men that they will see what I do and give God the glory. I am chosen and loved by God. I am chosen and loved by God. I am one of God's living stones, and I am being brought up as a spiritual house today. I am a chosen race, a royal priesthood. I am a holy holy nation, a people for God's own possession, to proclaim the excellence of him today. I am a friend of God and an enemy of the devil. Somebody needs to declare a peacemaker is an enemy of the devil. He wants us to have conflict. He wants us to be mad at each other, but I am an enemy of the devil. Oh God, I am a child of God, and I will resemble Christ when he returns. Now, I am not the great I am, but by the grace of God, I am who I am because of Jesus Christ. It's Christ in me. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I am justified, completely forgiven of all my sins. I am made righteous by the blood of Jesus. For by grace are we saved through faith, not of works. It is a gift of God. I thank God for the gift of salvation. I thank him for the blood of Jesus. I thank him for the price that Jesus paid. Because of the price that Jesus paid, I am dead with Christ and dead to the power of sin's rule over my life. I am dead, no longer I who live for myself, but I live for God. I live to please him. I live to please God for his glory. I do what I do, and all that I do it for the glory of God. I am bought with a price. I am not my own. I belong to God. I am not my own. My body does not belong to me. I am established. I am anointed. I am sealed by Christ, by God in Christ. I am given the Holy Spirit as a pledge, a guarantee of my inheritance today. I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me today. I am chosen in Christ before the foundation of the world. I am predestined, determined by God to be a son or a daughter. I am sanctified. I am one with the sanctifier, Jesus Christ. He is not ashamed to call me a brother or a sister. I have received the Spirit of God into my life that I might know the things given to me by God. I have been redeemed, forgiven. I am a recipient of his grace today in the name of Jesus, oh God. And because we are recipients of his grace, because we are citizens of the kingdom, in all that we do, ladies and gentlemen, let's do it for the glory of God. We're going to talk more about being a peacemaker this week. Oh, God, if not tomorrow, we're going to continue on the subject of what it means to be a peacemaker. For blessed are the peacemakers to be approved by God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons or the children of God. Tasha Cobbs is going to take us home with For Your Glory. Those on the call, please remain on the line.
Lift your worship now.
Travel near or far.
Travel near or far.
Now raise it up. And friends, for the last hour, you have been listening to Command Your Morning Prayer Line, live this morning from the Upper Room Ministries Incorporated, 702 R.C. Davis Parkway, out of Waycross, Georgia, where the pastor is Pastor Samuel Sellers III, the host of Command Your Mornings, now Monday through Friday, and that's 5 a.m. until 6 a.m. is Evangelist Dr. Renee Sellers. Don't forget to listen online 24-7, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day at www.foxy97.com. Command Your Morning is a service of the Upper Room Ministries Incorporated, 702 R.C. Davis Parkway, Waycross, Georgia.
Gotta be where you are. Gotta be where.